So, no introduction. What I want to show you is just one example of what we can do at that stage with this technique which I'm going to present you. And I will apply this just to one molecule, and in the end I will show you a little bit of outlook where we want to go. So the molecule which we are going to discuss is the following, which you have seen already many times. The physicist will call this a double dagger. That means we are squeezing, or the chemist is squeezing, a nice lanthanide ion inside with two ligands, phthalazine ligands. And the ion which we discuss here in this talk will be simply a terbium-3 plus ion. And the point is now we want to do some kind of information processing, quantum information processing, with the nuclear spin which sits on the terbium-3 plus ion. So how we do this? So the first thing we have to realize is that that this molecule has an electronic spin. And the electronic spin, which comes from the spin and the orbit, is coupled strongly together, gives you a J equals 6. So this J equals 6 sits in the field of the chemist, meaning the ligand field, and it distorts the ion in such a way that we end up with a ground state, which is MJ equals plus minus 6. That means for a physicist, we have an easing spin in the ground state, and all the excited states are very high in energy, and because we go to very low temperatures, we don't care about these states at that stage. So we have an easing spin, and as you have already seen, there's a nuclear spin sitting in the middle, and this nuclear spin is 3/2. There's only one isotope for terbium, so any terbium 3 plus ion will have a spin 3/2. And this will be our qubit. We will call this a qdit because it's not only two levels, but in this case we have four levels, energy levels. Now, this nuclear spin is seeing the electronic spin and sees local electric fields. So this gives rise to a hyperfine coupling, which has a term which is a very strong hyperfine coupling, here this very first term, and then a quadruple splitting, which comes from these electric fields, which split off the four states of this nuclear spin in such a way that we have three different frequencies to talk to these four different states. And this we are going to use in the following to make some kind of quantum processing, quantum information processing. So we have to read out now one nuclear spin. How we do this? So I will go quite fast because I've presented this in many conferences. Initially, I started with microsquids, which we then later on improved, and our first detector or sensor which could measure a single molecule was these kind of nanosquids, where we replaced the Josephson junction by carbon nanotubes, which are sitting here. So this device worked very well. Then we made other devices, like graphene-based systems or carbon nanotube-based systems, or we squeezed the molecule into the junction. All these different possibilities work very well, and we work on other possibilities at the moment. For example, we try to interface our molecule with a superconducting qubit, with a semiconducting qubit, or we try to read out the molecular system with a quantum emitter. So there are many possibilities, and as you can expect, you can also do the same thing with an STM, and I'm looking forward to this in the future, that what I'm going to present, that this is done with an STM in a very controlled way, and you have a lot of knobs which you can then use to tune the properties you're seeing. So here in this talk, I will limit the whole discussion to one possibility, and I leave it to you to look to the literature to see other results. So we'll focus down to this device, and we try to learn a little bit from what we did here. So what's the basic idea? The basic idea is that I have somewhere a quantum system, and I want to read it out. If this is a contradiction as such, because if you want to read out a quantum system, reading out means interacting with your quantum system, and then most of the time it becomes classical. So you have to read out your quantum system without destroying the quantumness of the system. And so how we do this? So we do this in such a way, in this way, that that we put here gold electrodes on the molecule, and we send current through the molecule, but not very close to our quantum system. That means we send the electrons through the ligand. The ligand forms some kind of quantum dot. We call this readout dot. And so we send the readout current, let's say, through the ligands. And then there's a very small coupling from these quantum dot, readout dot, to our electronic spin, which is this big terbium spin. And then this one is hyperfine coupled to the nuclear spin. That means what we do here is we map, in the end, a very tiny nuclear spin onto a big spin. This big spin is influencing a quantum dot, meaning shifting some levels. And this we read out with electrodes, that means with the environment. That means the decoherence, which comes from the environment, that means mainly source-drain electrodes, is not directly coupled to the nuclear spin. So when you want to do this with an SDM, you should do this, in my opinion, in a similar way. That means you should not talk directly with your quantum system, but you have to go via a sensor atom, what you do, for example, already for your measurements. So you need some indirect measurements to see the quantum system. So so this is the principal idea. Now, how we realize this, I will go very fast. We make some electron migration, we squeeze the molecule inside, we see then with maps of source drain voltage versus gate voltage, we measure the differential conductance, we see this quantum dot, and then with some efforts we see jumps, and we prove then, I do this very quickly again, that we can measure really the nuclear spin. So what is the basis of these measurements? Well, here this is the ground state of the big electronic spin up or down, and as a function of applied field. So this is called a Zeeman diagram. So if imagine your electronic spin is in this state, if I sweep my field from the left to the right, here it's zero field, so this is exactly zero field. Here I have a voided level crossing. That means when I sweep my field, I can get here tunneling from this up state to the down state. This will depend on the sweep rate and so on. The important thing is it happens exactly at zero field. But this was without nuclear spin. So now I will switch on the hyperfine coupling. And when you do this, you see that this transition, which was exactly zero field, is shifted to four different fields, which will depend on your nuclear spin state. That means our readout method is simply we measure where the electronic spin can tunnel, at what field it can tunnel, and then this tells us directly in what nuclear spin state we are. So experimentally, this looks like this. We look, we set the system at a certain working point where the system works well. We can discuss this. We measure the differential conductance at this working point, and we sweep the applied field. And when everything is well tuned, we see, for example, a jump. And then we repeat the same measurement many, many times. And then you will see that when everything is fine for a terbium 3 plus ion, you will see four different possibilities towards the spin, which then map directly onto the Zeeman diagram without any fitting parameter. So at that stage, you can prove quite easily that you can only have a terbium 3 plus ion in your junction. Of course, there's some lot of work hidden, which I will skip. Now, we want to come to quantum operations. So the first step is initialization. So this has been mentioned many times. So for us, the initialization is a trivial thing, because when you have a single quantum system, you just measure the quantum system, and it is a certain state. So this is we call initialization. We measure it in a certain quantum state, and then from there on, you can make any kind of pulses to go to any other state. So we initialize simply by measuring the system. And so this we showed already some time ago. So here, just to illustrate this, we measure here, we sweep the field, the applied field always up and down, and then we see these jumps, and these happen exactly in these four different bands for the four different nuclear spin states. And so we simply can measure the system. So I go over this very quickly, because these measurements give you T1, the lifetime of your qubit in one of these states, and in this case it's of the order of 10 seconds. It's long for our application, but if you look closer, in fact it's short. If the system would not be coupled to a source and drain electrode, it would be thousands of seconds at these temperatures. So the important thing is that we initialize our system, and it lives a long time in these states. Now we have to manipulate the system. It has been mentioned several times at this conference the following thing, that when you want to manipulate a spin, that means you want to put it from one state to bring it from one state to another state, you can apply a magnetic field which is oscillating at the right frequency, that means the right energy, and you apply this transverse to the spin direction. However, a magnetic field the magnetic field you need for a very tiny nuclear spin, to manipulate it very fast, this field must be very large. And most of the time, this is technically not so easy. So what we do is, we remember that our nuclear spin is hyperfine coupled to this big electronic spin. And now we use an electric field, and we tune the hyperfine constant. And this will manipulate our nuclear spin much better, because if you go through the mass of the whole thing, you find out that a very tiny change of the hyperfine constant, that means a change of the order of 10 to minus 4, very tiny, if you go through the mass, corresponds to an effective B field, which is huge. So 100 millitesla applied at frequencies of gigahertz is experimentally very difficult to do. Here, via the electric field, we can do this. And this allows us to manipulate the nuclear spin quite quickly. So all what is following is always divided in three steps. That means the first thing is we always initialize our system. So here, for a very simple case, let's say we initialize our system in the 3/2 state. So we measure it, we initialize it, it's there. Then, in the next step, we will apply a pulse. So this pulse at the very beginning of the following will be very simple at the beginning, and then I make more and more complicated pulses. So here, just a pulse. A pulse is always a certain frequency, or several frequencies, and a certain length, a certain amplitude. And then, so this is the manipulation of the spin, and then I have to find out what happened. So then I read it out, my nuclear spin. So for a very simple pulse, I can expect only two possible outcomes. Either I measure my spin still in 3/2, or if the frequency was simple, then it's in 1/2. And then, well, this gives you one result. This doesn't tell you anything when you have quantum mechanics. You have to make many, many measurements to get a mean value of what you measure. That means you measure probabilities to find your system in another state after your spin manipulation. And there, the important thing goes in. That means how much time I now need to initialize, make the manipulation. The manipulation is fast when you take electric field, and then the readout. So here in this, the whole overhaul cycle should be fast if you want to go for quite ambitious manipulations in the end. Here we are not yet as fast. That means we need typically for the whole cycle of one realization of a measurement, we need a second, maybe a little bit faster, but we're of the order of seconds. Other systems like superconducting qubits can do this at microseconds. So this is already much better than when you want to go to further results. Now, for us it's 1 second. That means whatever I show you in the following, each point, which is cycling of this 100 or 1,000 times, means the whole point needed 1 thousandth of seconds. So, very simple manipulation. That means I apply now a certain microwave on the system, and I will have a certain amplitude, and I will apply these pulses longer and longer. And for each point, I make these measurements several times, and then I get out what I call a visibility to find my system either in the same state when I started or in the other state. So when I do this, and here I will show you the very first measurements some time ago, going back to Stefan Thiele. In order to honor it, I will show his results first. You see that the visibility to find your system first in the ground state and oscillates. That means first you're in the ground state, and then you oscillate to the other state, and then it comes back. So these oscillations are called Rabi oscillations, and the frequency of this oscillation will depend on the amplitude of your microwave power. So these very first measurements have been improved by the second student, which was Clément Godefrin. And then the oscillations are much better, and you will see more results in the following. Before we come to this, I will show you something else which will be very important in the following, not in this talk, but in the following studies on these kind of systems. And this this is that we can tune the resonance frequency with static applied fields. So here I show you that these resonance frequency at the gate voltage of this value is exactly this frequency. But if I change my gate voltage, you see that I can change my resonance frequency, and this will be very important when you play with many nuclear spins. You will have to shift around the frequencies in order to couple and decouple and so on. So next important thing is how long I can store a quantum information in my nuclear spin. So the general first operation you use to do this is called Ramsey operation. And so what you do here is simply you initialize your system, then you put it in a superposition state. You made a Hadamard gate or a pi over 2 pulse, and then you simply wait a certain time. During this waiting time, your system can interact with the environment and can dephase. And this you will see then when you make another pi over 2 pulse, you project it back to the other side. When you measure it then, if your outcome is then corresponding to a pi pulse, then it means that nothing happened during the waiting time. If you get random outcome in the end, this means you lost the quantum phase and something disturbed the system. So you make this waiting time longer and longer, and then if everything is fine, you get these Ramsey fringes. Here again, these very first measurements, Clément did this much better, and here you see his results for the three different microwave frequencies, Rabi oscillations. These are the resonance frequencies. Here you have the Ramsey result, and for some people here also spin echo if you want. The important thing is now you have to divide the Rabi time, that means how fast you can make a pi over 2 pulse, with the coherence time T2 or T2 star, like you want. And the important thing in our case is that we get a figure of merit of the order of 10,000. That means in principle you can make 10,000 operations before you lose your quantum phase. So this is important. But as I already mentioned, the other important thing is not only the quality factor, it's also how fast you can measure your system. So I have a very good quality factor, but I need 1 second to make one realization, and this will make me trouble in the following. You will see the data will be noisy, simply due to the fact that I can't make a large statistics. So now we come to quantum operations. What is a quantum operation? So a quantum operation in the end are unitary transformations of a certain initial state. I make put my quantum system in a certain state, I make unitary transformations, more or less complicated, and this I will call a quantum gate. And the funny thing, and the good, or the good thing, is that any complicated operation I can separate into 2-qubit operations, and then apply them a sequence of 2-qubit operations. So this we are going to do in the following. Now, a unitary transformation in the end is simply a rotation or reflection of your state on the block sphere. So if I start at a certain point and then I go to another point, the important thing in the end for quantum operations are the phases which are changing. So I have to get a control on the phase after a certain quantum operation. So that's why we have to figure out experimentally now, when I make a unitary transformation, how I can convince you that this unitary transformation has the right quantum phase at the end. So if you want to measure phases in optics, you know very well, that's quite easy. We just take a laser and you have a beam splitter. So you split your beam, so you have a reference beam. And then the other part of the beam, you can dephase. And then you interfere both beams in the end together. And the interference pattern which you will get tells you something about the phase which I get here on this arm of the interference experiment. So for my nuclear spin, I have to do the same thing. I need to make something which gives a certain phase, and in the end, I have to find this phase. So how I can do this? So for nuclear spin, here illustrated for 3 different states, I do the following. I initialize my system in a certain state, and then the beam splitter means that I make a Hadamard gate and split off my beam. That means I have a superposition between these 2 different states. And then from this superposition state, I can, on this side, I take another frequency, I can make a pi pulse to this state, for example. And when I go back, I can add a phase. So this I can do with my arbitrary wave function generator. And now the deal is that I have to figure out this phase which I added. I have to measure it. So in order to measure it, I simply have to interfere these 2 different beams in the end with another Hadamard gate or pi over 2 pulse. And in order to convince you then, I will change the phase of this Hadamard gate so that I can cancel the phase which I added here. So here is one of these demonstrations. I make exactly this sequence. I start off with this level. I make a Hadamard gate, and then I added here a phase theta. And in order to find out that I added this phase theta experimentally, I have here phi, which I tune in order to cancel the theta. And if then the phi is canceling the theta, I get my state, which was initially here, I get it out here. And this is now shown in this map, where I scan theta and I can scan phi, and when I cancel both phases, then I get these fringes. So I get in the end theta plus phi over 2 interference. So here everything worked. So I play with my qubit, I try to convince you that I can play, and then you look at the noise and then you can interfere how good we are. So this is the easy part. Now let's make it more complicated. So here I make the same thing. I split off my beam. Then I make a pi pulse to go to green, another pi pulse to go to blue. And when I go back, each time I add a theta. And then interfere this. So I get 2 theta plus phi over 2 interference. Still, this works. I see 2 times more fringes. So this works again. Here, Clément added 2 thetas, theta 1 here and theta 3, and then you get this theta 1 plus theta 3 over 2 interference. So this is our game, just to see how good we can do this. Now, let's make a more complicated gate. So this we call an I-swap gate. So an I-swap gate, the unitary transformation matrix looks like this. You have here I is an imaginary factor, so a phase factor. So you have to swap two states and put an I phase I. So these you can write down with rotation matrices if you want. So if you map now this is a 2-qubit basis, you can map our four-level system on a 2-qubit basis, and then you can make these I swap with our four levels. So if you do this, then the I swap is simply a 3-pi pulse between these two levels. So if I tell you this, you will tell me, well, this is just Rabi oscillation between these two states. So I have to prove now that Rabi oscillations of pi or 3-pi is something different. Experimentally, if I make now this operation, again, I measure my state populations. You see they're oscillating between these two states as a function of the length of the pulse. So this is what I expect. But now I have to show you to you that this state or this state is different by 2-pi. 2-pi is a phase factor which disappears very easily. So how I can prove that I have this I swap? So the solution of Clemer was the following. I have to put my unitary transformations into something more complicated. So what he did here is this sequence of pulses. And here you see the pi pulse. Or he makes the same sequence with a 3-pi pulse. And then, depending on if it's pi pulse or a 3-pi pulse, you will end up in the green state, or in the blue state, or in the green state. So this is just a proof that you have these 3-pi. So theoretically, this works, of course. So quantum mechanics on the computer works all the time. Now you have to show this experimentally, and you will see that Clemer got it working. So he could get out the blue state here, and here the green. But you start to see noise. It doesn't come up to unity. You start to see that experimentally it is becoming more and more complicated. So these 3 minutes means that this question is 3 minutes. Okay, so sorry, I spent again too much time to come to the nice stuff. So here, this is a Hadamard gate with 3 states. It's very interesting if you look closer, because you see that your T2 becomes shorter than when you make Hadamard gates with 2 states. Well, this is normal, but this shows you the complication you will get when you want to go to many, many spins. So I want to flash very quickly a proposal of Daniel Loss. Because he likes to say that he proposes stuff, and then 15 years later, the experimentalists finally realized these results. So indeed, he proposed here some algorithm, and it's a Grover algorithm to search in a quantum base. All is funny, no problem. But experimentally, to realize this is not as easy. And Clemer tried to do this. So this was his PhD subject, in fact. He should have started with this at the beginning, and it was quite a pain in the neck. So in the Grover algorithm, what you do in the end is you start off with a state, then you mix up all the system, you make a mixture with all the states, and then in these mixed up bases, you have to search each element. So here with 3 states, I mix them up, and then in the end, I have to find each state again. So if you do this classically, once you mix them up, you can't just find back one state. So quantum mechanically, you can do this, and this is the Grover algorithm. Now, Clemer worked a lot. And in fact, it didn't work. So here, he made a Hadamard gate with 4 states, so he mixed them up, and then at that stage, he wanted to get out each of these states. So he wanted to apply this theory. And so it didn't work because the theorist didn't make any mistake. But he put the phases to 0, when experimentally this is not as simple. Theoretically, you can easily put phase 0 to all states, and then you make your calculation, and then it's done. But experimentally, here, Clemer made a mistake. That means he made a Hadamard gate, mixed up all 4 states, but each state was not initialized to phase 0. And this made him trouble, so that's why it didn't work, and he worked a lot, and finally found out how to do this, to get exactly to this Hadamard point, where all the phases are zero. You see this when you go tangentially to this point, then your phases are zero. And then from this point on, so this length of pulse, then this was the right preparation to then make the Grover pulse and to pull out, for example, the green state, the red state, the black state needed quite some time to get it out, but finally could do it. So this is again just a quantum game to show you that physicists can be quite excited with just four states and play 3 years just to control four states, more or less. I have to conclude by saying that I showed you one example of these very nice, beautiful molecules which are around. We played with just one nuclear spin inside the system. We have some handle on it, but you see that certain stage our measurements are noisy. And the main reason why they are so noisy is that our repetition rate of the whole cycle we are doing is too slow. So we have to integrate over weeks sometimes to get the whole figure which you are seeing. So during weeks, everything must be stable. The phases should not change and so on. And this, in the end, makes us troubles. So we have to make it faster. And that's why we work on other readout methods. We work also on more complicated molecules. And just to show you very quickly what this means, I show you this molecule. So here we have just two times the double decker. So you have here terbium 3 plus and here terbium 3 plus. So that means one nuclear spin here, one here. These two are coupled via the electronic spin. And if you now look only to the ground state, what you see is a Zemi diagram, which is much more complicated. This is our working basis at the moment. So we try to work on these different levels. And you see that we get troubles in the sense of frequency crowding. That means there are transitions which have nearly the same frequencies, and then how you distinguish what you do in the whole process. So this is one of our problems which we are trying to solve. And as I said, we want to use quantum emitters to read out the system locally at different positions and so on. So I have to thank Clément, who did a great job. I want to thank all the chemists who are working with us on this subject. For this talk here, it was Marie Uben who made this nice molecule, or a chemist in his group. I have to thank my new team in Karlsruhe, who is courageous enough to start with me. And here is just a picture of what we did in the beginning. We had to build our fridges. So not my students, but I built the fridges, and the students are using them. And so I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Wolfgang, for a very exciting talk.